I was intrigued by some of the solar generators I've been seeing, like the Goal Zero Yeti and other similar units. Being a techie, it occurred to me that I should be able to build a reasonable equivalent for less than those units go for. Although I have several fuel-driven generators, total power down replacement in a prolonged grid down situation isn't very practical. Anything more than a few days would need substantial fuel reserves, which would require a disciplined strategy to rotate the fuel, amongst other considerations. In the Southwest, we have plenty of sun, so a solar generator seemed like a good addition, so I set out to build my own. After doing some homework, I set the following goals. The unit had to have a reasonably high output, something similar to a small gasoline generator. It needed to be reasonably portable, something my wife could move around the property to provide 110-volt power where it was needed, and could be easily positioned to catch the sun in different seasons and at different times of the day. It needed to have a power reserve capacity similar to the units available for purchase, and it needed to be affordable. So here's the unit I put together. For storage capacity, I chose a high-capacity Group 27 deep-cycle marine battery. The deep cycle type will tolerate repeated discharges to around 50% without damaging the battery. It should tolerate a daily charge and discharge cycle for some time and will provide daily power for considerably longer than any reasonable expectation for fuel-driven generators. The inverter is a Go Power unit rated at 1750 watts, which produces sine wave power suitable for sensitive electronics and has the power to accommodate any appliance we own. It features a voltage and power monitor display and two AC outlets. To connect more items simultaneously, I added a power strip with USB charging. This adds four outlets and two USB charging ports at the cost of using one of the two outlets on the inverter. Since the inverter will lose a certain amount of power to its own inefficiencies, I envisioned charging all of the devices for my family or group simultaneously, so having multiple outlets is important. I used Serenergy 200-watt dual-panel solar bundle kit, which has two 100-watt solar panels, a charge controller, and all the wiring for the solar side of the generator. The charge controller has a 400-watt capacity, so I could add two more of the 4-foot by 2-foot panels to improve recharge time. To keep the whole rig ready to go, I added a Black & Decker automatic battery maintainer. This keeps the battery at full charge, so I always have full capacity should I need the unit. Finally, all of this went on a Harbor Freight heavy-duty hand truck. A friend welded some angle brackets to the platform to form a box that holds the battery perfectly and painted it to match the truck. He also put some diamond mesh and a heavy rubber mat in the bottom to make the box drainable. A square of painted half-inch plywood bolted to the truck uprights is a sturdy and convenient mounting surface for all the hardware. The hand truck form factor, along with the heavy oversized tires, makes rolling the unit very easy, even on dirt or rough surfaces. The downside of the cart is that taking the unit in a vehicle will require a minute or two to remove the battery so it won't leak when laying the cart over. One unexpected benefit of this kind of setup is in storing the unit. It's tall, so it doesn't have a very big footprint in my garage, and it's extremely convenient if I need to move it out of the way of something. For comparison, I think there's an optional cart available for the Yeti unit, so it's more convenient to move the 103-pound unit around. On their website, they show a two-man carry, whereas mine's reasonably easy to roll from place to place and would be considerably easier up and downstairs. Now for performance. I think one of the most popular comparable units would be the Goal Zero Yeti 1250. That unit specs out to 1250 watts with 100 amp power reserve. That means it can handle loads of up to 1250 watts and is rated to carry a 25 amp load, roughly 300 watts, for about 4 hours before the battery hits 50% capacity. The 50% value matters because discharges below this value will reduce the battery's capacity and shorten its service life. My unit is rated at 1750 watts with a 95 amp hour reserve, so it can handle the same 300 watt load for just a little less than 4 hours. To get a better sense of what this means, my unit could power a box fan for about 6 hours, an LCD TV for about 12 hours, a very small fridge for about 40 hours, or a hairdryer for about 45 minutes. A higher wattage rating means my unit can, if necessary, handle high-load appliances like a hairdryer or a coffee maker, or the starting load of motorized appliances like larger fridges or AC units for at least short periods of time. Since the unit is an open design, I can also extend the reserve by connecting additional batteries. With a set of jumper cables, I could connect the battery of any of our cars to the battery in the unit, extending the total reserve available for the inverter. In comparison, the Yeti has a nicer display and lots of power plug options, so it can connect to a myriad of devices and can be stacked and ganged with other Yetis. I really like those features, but I have all the 110-volt and USB basics covered. So let's talk costs. Looking at a good ready-to-buy alternative, The Yeti 1250 Portable Power Station Kit includes the Yeti 1250 unit and two 100-watt solar panels for just under $2,000. The total build cost for my unit was $692.65, roughly one-third of the price. It's not as compact and not nearly as pretty, but it does the same job with 40% more wattage and is much more convenient to move. I've posted the complete build list in the description below in case you'd like a starting point for building your own solar generator. If I get an opportunity to test a Yeti or other unit, I'll develop and run some real-world tests to see how they compare and post the videos. I also think I'll run a comparison to the three fuel-driven generators I own, so watch for that video. So what do you think? What did I miss? Where am I off base? What better choices could I have made? Post your comments below. I'm always happy to hear from you, and I learn a lot from your comments and suggestions. Thanks for watching. Don't forget to like the video, and please subscribe. That way you'll know when new videos come out.